With the clinical innovation and technological advancements, the paradigm of surgical procedures on the spine and their perioperative management are rapidly evolving, right from the single level decompressions to multi-level extensive reconstructions. Introduction of the TLA-FM, the MIS have now changed the scenario altogether of spine surgery and the anesthetic managements. There are open spine surgeries or minimally invasive or endoscopic and robotics. The different types of anesthesia, GA initially was the gold standard, but with the minimally invasive, the regionals also have now come into the picture. However, whatever the type of surgery, there are a few challenges which still remain for any spine surgery. These are difficult intubation, major blood loss, long duration of surgery, problems related to positioning and perioperative complex pain management, and nowadays the problem of ERAS. We have to have minimal invasive and we have to follow the ERAS protocols. Let me tackle the site-specific complications. In a cervical spine surgery, with all the problems, we expect difficult intubation. If there is anterior approach, there can be a recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy, bradycardia, cardiovascular instability due to involvement of the carotid sheath or hypotension. During the thoracic spines, we have a lot of blood loss is expected, cord injury may be there, post-op the patient may require respiratory support. Now, navigating through these complications and their solutions, let's tackle one by one. Most important in prevention, I think there is a preoperative concerns which have to be optimized. Regarding the airway in a cervical, we must, so we come back to the preoperative optimization. So as far as the cervical surgeries are concerned, the airway is a difficult thing. The, as we all know, all inline stabilization equipment as well as restricted neck extension will hamper the airway. Intubation may be difficult. Respiratory system, they may be compromised in the congenital deformities. They may be compromised respiratory function preoperatively, which has to be evaluated properly. And patient-specific factors now, we have to optimize. As an anesthetist, we are concerned more about hemoglobin optimization than optimization of the comorbid conditions like diabetes. So HbA1c less than 7, then blood pressure has to be optimized, and smoking, if it is there, the patient has to stop that. Improper positioning, Dr. Raghu has very well explained about the prone positioning and all. What I would highlight is the kinking of the tube in the prone position, which can occur with extreme flexion of the neck. This can be avoided by using an armored or flexometallic tube which is non-kinkable. As anesthetists, we are equally concerned about the post-operative visual loss which can occur not only due to improper pressure, not only due to pressure, but there are other factors like the maintenance of the mean arterial pressures. It has to be, the induced hypotension has not to cross the limits. It should never be less than 70 for a prolonged time. It can cause compromise of the retinal vessels and can cause even simple things like corneal ulcerations can occur. Prone position, abdomen being not free, can cause increased pressure on the inferior vena cava and cause of lot of congestion in the paravertebral veins, which itself will lead to lot of oozing, and whatever you do, the BP and the oozing will not stop. It will be hampering the surgery. And of course, we have the pressure points to be taken care of the peripheral nerves. Then ideal prone, this is already dealt with. During intubation, one has to choose. This is very important from the anesthetist point of view. It mainly with the direct laryngoscope, conventional may not work. One has to anticipate a difficult intubation, keep a video laryngoscope or a fiber optic laryngoscope ready. So these are the techniques which one must master if you are going to use complicated spine surgeries, right? So there are certain pitfalls which can occur. Nowadays, the choice of anesthesia, this is regarding the choice of anesthesia. General anesthesia was the gold standard. With the endoscopic procedures, now conscious sedation, and this is possible. The disadvantage of conscious sedation during these surgeries is that the surgical duration, though small, the blood loss is less, duration of the hospital stay is less, but you have to remember that the maintenance of a patent airway, your airway here is not secured with the endotracheal tube. So you have to be very careful, and this is what is challenging. Post-op nausea vomiting has to be taken care of properly. In the lumbar region, if we give regional anesthesia, it's fine, but the problems with spinal, epidural or any form of regional anesthesia for single level spine surgeries is that the airway, if at all, is going to get compromised intraoperatively, the access is very difficult. So when an anticipated difficult intubation is there, never go ahead with only regional. Always secure the endotracheal tube intubation and then hand over the patient to the surgeon. In conditions which are not suitable for conscious sedation or standalone regional anesthesia, one must keep in mind where general anesthesia is required, you will have to do it in morbidly obese patients, patients with compromised coronary function, and this is a little bit about that, right? Now, intraoperative concerns are again massive blood loss, and you have to be ready with that. Then the surgeries are divided as minor, major, and complex as per the blood loss is anticipated. So the central peripheral line has to be secured properly, and how you can reduce the blood during bleeding during the spine surgery is in the hands of the anesthetist. There are measures of giving induce hypotension, antifibrillatory therapy, hemodilution, anti-autotransfusion, cell salvage can be also practiced. Now, how to prevent eye injuries? As I said, mean arterial pressure should not drop below 70 millimeters, even during the induced hypotensive technique. Maintenance of adequate perfusion pressure with IV fluids and colloids is equally important. Vasopressors may be used. Correction of anemia preoperatively and proper positioning, of course, goes a long way. And hypothermia is very important. It always, if it is occurring for the long procedures, then it will also hamper with the neuromonitoring. So hypothermia should not occur. You can use air warmers, you can use fluid warmers, you can use blood warmers and prevent, and don't let the ambient OT temperature fall below 21. Let the orthopedic surgeon sweat and shout, but don't let it go below 21 for longer times. So monitoring of the core temperature, very, very important in all the spine surgeries. Then venous thromboembolism is a part and a complication by itself, is as usual, and it can be tackled the way as we do for other surgeries. Now, regarding intraoperative monitoring, basic monitors, besides the basic monitors, whenever you are doing the neuro monitoring, you have to also have preferably a monitor for the depth of anesthesia, like BIS or entropy, which is desirable, but not always available. Same way with the neuro monitoring, I may elaborate a little more, SSEP, motor evoked potential, electromyography, and the wake-up test. Wherever the specialized neuromonitoring, as the sir already mentioned, there are only 2-3 available. If you want, you have to pre-book for the neuromonitoring. You need a technician or an engineer for that. So if you don't have all those facilities and you still want to test the motor, this thing, you can do what is called as a wake-up test. So I'll just go through that. These are the pathways which are involved. You have the sensory cortex, cervical spine, epidural. This, I think most of the orthopedic patients would be knowing what all you monitor in this. Then there is the, now regarding the SSEP, I would like to tell that it will monitor the integrity of the dorsal columns. It is provide a measurable display of amplitude and latency. The ulnar and the tibial nerves, posterior tibial nerves, are usually used. 300 to 500 electrical stimuli are delivered to provide an average waveform. Significant decrease in amplitude is what we have to look out as anesthetists. Significant decrease in amplitude and or a significant increase in the latency is associated with potential changes in neurological status of the patient. Whether the screw is too tight, whether the manipulation is too needs to be altered, this all has to be seen before the surgeon closes. So this is where we can help the surgeon by monitoring the SSEP. The surgeon is typically notified. When do we notify the surgeon? When there is a unilateral or a bilateral amplitude loss of at least 50% to 60%, or there is a 10% increase in the latency. Regarding this, you also have to watch out that there are various factors like the inhalation agents, then hypothermia, then all these have to be properly taken care of. It is observed through studies that even adding desflurane 0.3 mac will depress. So first of all, whenever you see an altered SSEP which requires a red signal to the surgeon, first rule out all this as an anesthetist, stop or decrease the inhalation, decrease the anesthetic agent and treat hypothermia and improve the perfusion, and then watch out and then inform the surgeon. If all these factors are ruled out, then the surgeon needs to do something about it. So the red light zone which is there on the tracing is where you should be careful about. So that is about SSEP. MEP also, same ways, there are red alert. Now this patient is undergoing a cervical spine surgery, and there are signals where the MEP was augmented and suddenly disappeared in the middle of foramen magnum decompression. Then it again slowly recovered, because the children are more prone to hypothermia and there were many factors. Once you correct them and if it recovers, then the surgeon doesn't have to do anything about it. If not, then of course the manipulation and all, the surgeon has to recheck. So when do you have to recover transient discontinuation of the procedure has to, once you notice it, all the same, you have to alert the surgeon, stop the procedure, irrigate the surgical field with saline solution for removing of the blood products and metabolites. It says that extracellular potassium accumulation which occurs can itself cause a strong axonal blocking. So you can just wait for some time, push some saline on it, then the sustained hypotension may be there. So that you'd start treating, get the BP up to 90 millimeters, so mean arterial pressure up to 90, then temporary moderate elevation of the mean artery pressure may restore the blood flow and you may lead to improvement of the D waves and muscle MEP successfully if ischemia due to insufficient MEP is the primary cause. So rule out all that first, and then when dissection in a particular location results in MEP changes, the resection at a different site can proceed without further aggravation. Preventing hypothermia. So treat hypothermia, try to warm the patient, see if the changes are regressing. Reduction of applied, correction of removal of anchoring hardware. So whatever hardware is placed, you may tell the surgeons to relax that a bit and then again watch for the changes. A steroid bolus may help. So give a steroid bolus like methylprednisolone or dexamethasone. It can be also considered while the surgeon is waiting. Finally, if there is no noticeable neurophysiological improvement in response to all these methods described above, then you should consider removing the spinal implant or discontinuing the tumor resection. That is about our neuromonitoring and how to make use of it and help the surgeons to decide about his neurological deficits. Now the wake-up test, many surgeons used to do in the olden times, and it is still useful if you don't have a specific, especially in scoliosis surgery. Now how to go about it? The surgeon cannot say on table, chalo, patient ko uthao, I want to do a wake-up test. No, that is where the briefing comes in. The surgeon has to talk to the anesthetist, I want to do a wake-up test. So what we do is we counsel the patient before the surgery is done and we tell and instruct the patient. The scoliosis surgery is usually 11, 12 years, they are very scared. And even adults are very scared to wake up when your whole spine is open and then try moving your feet, not done. So you have to properly explain the patient. Lighting of anesthesia at an important appropriate point during the procedure and observing the patient's ability to move to command. The patient is asked that you move your toes. So this can test only the motor part. So that is how we do a wake-up test. And anesthesia requirements are specially that during that test, we have to again perform skill. Anesthesiologist has to be there, reliable but quickly antagonized. Drugs like remifentanil do help a lot in wakening and should be smooth. No pain during the test should be there, and there should be no recall by the patient of this horrifying experience he will feel otherwise. So that is what is important. Okay, so these are indicated in spine deformity surgeries, counseled and informed preoperatively, awakened during the surgery. The anesthetic drugs have to be discontinued temporarily. And most important, after the surgery, the surgeon is happy that the patient can move the feet, again put the patient to sleep so that he can finish the closure. So that is about the wake-up test, right? And the scale is good, satisfactory, poor. And of course, in this also many factors would come in place. The patient may not wake up. adequately enough to follow your command. So all these are part and parcel. The postoperative complications again would be dural punctures, then postoperative. Most important complication is the pain, which have to be tackled by giving either preemptive analgesics like pre and paragabalin and all, or even in the postoperative period, be careful to the post-op. Usually hypothermia, blood loss has to be adequately replaced in the So the recent advances now, we have these all endoscopic procedures, looking forward to low blood loss, early ambulation, lesser pain, short hospital stay and ERAS. And this is the future of anesthetic practices. From the days of general anesthesia and its complications, we may just switch over to regionals or conscious sedation. And we have the use of regional anesthesia like fluoroscopic guided epidural anesthesia with conscious sedation in high risk surgical patients. Use of course, robotic surgeries would again have MAC sleepy and robotic spine surgeries, which may come in. Right? So I'm extremely thankful to my JR Ranjani Ramchandran for helping me in preparing this presentation. Thank you.